35 years have passed now, and I feel it's time that we change. The moment that I've actually realized for myself that it strongly needs to change, and it can change, it's possible, is because 5 years ago I moved to the United States because of a personal requirement. And I see changes happening every day over there. Regardless of what background you're coming from, all ideas are encouraged. And I always wonder, how is it that they grow without any judgment? And that is because they are culturally, they've culturally integrated the system where they can all grow together regardless of, you know, there's no gender bias. So regardless of what sex you have, what color you have, yes, there's still elements of racism there, which I don't want to highlight on right now. But every idea is welcomed, and every idea has some sort of leverage and space to grow. The same can be applied to India as well. We are still a developing nation. We have a prime minister who's actually come in, you know, who wants to see stark changes happen. Because I think even introducing certain reforms in the last governing year, I don't think it came easy. It came, GST okay, introducing the permit was very harsh. It was a harsh implementation. So those are the ways of the West as well. And I see there is a big potential for India to change the way it teaches the future generation.
Since we are focusing on this educational sector, as I said, in every sector there is disruption happening. As a person traveling to all over the world, you can see that, you know, drastic changes in education when compared to US and India. There's a lot of changes there. So for at least for our future generations, what we can bring into our educational system, because the industry always complains that there is a lack of practical or skill learning for our students.
We have access to too much information is what I would say. So what happens with access to too much information is you have so much going on in your head. It's like turning on 1,000 televisions at once. The child is not able to see which channel does he or she actually want to focus on. So what this particular place does is it helps people develop specific skills. Because today we are moving into a world where automation is taking over labor, right? So India is a country with a lot of, you know, I always say population is one of our biggest issues. We have to prepare, or we have to create more specifically skilled people. Let us say tomorrow one huge industry is going to open up. That industry is going to require people who are skilled in a very particular way. And our current education system is not providing that. So B-Hub would be creating the space where people who have already worked in those, you know, in those infrastructures can come and share their experiences and teach, or at least influence the minds of, you know, those who are around us, or even young children, middle-aged people, to start thinking differently, or at least using those, at least start thinking in that direction. The biggest change needs to come, like I said, the first education being from home begins with a parent speaking about the future and about the possibilities of a rebelling child. Let's say a child in our community, a rebelling child is considered to be, you know, adakkum odukkum illatha kutti, right? So I feel when you rebel with a cause, there is huge potential in that child. That child might be differently skilled. Enhance that, work on that, encourage that, provide that person a platform to be at that person's worst or at her best. So that's what B-Hub is trying to create, and I think this change just comes with awareness that something needs to change. Not by unnecessarily involving yourself on social media, and it has its pluses and minuses, but I feel in the generation we're spending too much wasted time on the phone. Neramachi, you can actually spend productive time, you know, to think creatively, to do something better. It's such a complex world that it just begins with one thing called awareness that I need to change, that I need to think differently, I need to do something better. And I need to go to a platform or I need to go to a space where my idea can be received, something can be made out of it, I get some, you know, some sharing in return, some exchanges happen, and then I come back home and your idea has actually taken a few more steps forward. So it begins with realizing that I need to change or I need to think differently. I can. Not that someone aarum adichamarthunnonnilla. It is possible. And it is possible nalladana. I want to create that as a resounding, you know, oru logan for B-Hub. That it is possible. And it is regardless of how old you are, how I know that a 10-year-old kid and a 50-year-old retired person who's coming from, you know, he could be a retired scientist, he could be coming and passing on some very fruitful information to this child and therefore inspiring that child to become a better citizen of India, you know, and therefore the world.
It's not possible for any government to provide job opportunities for all because unemployment is a real big issue for India. So when coming to this particularly women entrepreneurs, do you think that the women empowerment comes through entrepreneurship? Because entrepreneurship means doing something independently. What is your advice or what you can say to the women in business to focus more on the entrepreneurship?
I think from birth, I think women are the ones, especially in India, I think women are amazing at business. We have a natural skill to micromanage because we are, like I said, we are already aware beings. I think an Indian woman, you know, in the West there is this big comedy. They say, do you know why Indian women wear like this red bindi? It's the record button. So that's because they never forget anything. And that tradition has been passed on through generations, right? So women are best at, you know, naturally doing, running the home business. And it's one of the hardest businesses to manage. But you know, fast forwarding, and today, you know, we're in the 21st century, and women, like a lot of housewives are starting micro business. They would sit at home using social media. This is where it becomes, you know, one of the most useful tools, I feel. Portals like Instagram and Facebook is helping them, you know, promote their own business just at the comfort of their very 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 home. But that being said, I feel that because the government is not able to, you know, assign jobs to every person that is around, and also gender inequality is a very, very big issue. We have a huge disparity in pay roles as well. These things seem to be very, very difficult to be bridged. It is not just in India. This is a global problem. Okay, it's there in the United States as well. Unemployment is there. Women are not happy with their payrolls. Men have high priority in almost all industries. Cinema as well. So instead of complaining, how can we change this? Right? I feel that is where. See, these are the little things that. Why do we sit and complain? Why do we sit and complain about how to bridge the gap between these two genders, or you know, how can women come exactly at the same level as men? No, I don't think that's an active, you know, that's a very healthy debate to have or a healthy thought to have. We're not in competition with anyone, but while holding our own sexes in pride, we have the most impact on the next generation. I think as women, our maternal energies can be used to inspire the next generation in the right way and give them better guidance. And the more we are hearing about women empowerment today, I feel that our little boys are also aware of the fact that we're growing up in a world where women empowerment is the most, you know, fashionable word. So I feel that going forward, we're going to be faced with a world where, this is because I'm thinking about the future, okay? I think we're going to be faced with a world where men are going to feel challenged by women. So that can also happen. So why don't you think about the flip side, right? So we're actually between a paradigm shift right now, especially India. I feel we're really changing, we're transforming. The future looks very bright. This is exactly when we need a place of exchange, where regardless of, you know, whether you're a man, woman, you have one place where your voice can be heard, where your ideas can be propelled forward, and none of that will be judged, and it will get somewhere someday.
Coming to the cinema, we can see now celebrities, they are, you know, taking the role of investors. Yes, Shah Rukh Khan has initiated this years back. Yes. Deepika, Aishwarya Rajinikanth, all of them are, you know, they are taking the role of investors. So how can you this correlate this cinema and entrepreneurship?
Both are only done with passion. I think I can't speak for anybody else, but I can speak for myself. I don't get involved in anything that I don't fully understand. Okay, so something that I don't love, I don't do it. If I'm not fully there, if my interest in that is just half, I'm yet to understand the process, I don't even go to it. I'd rather step back, learn it fully, and then reapproach it if I need to. So it took me a lot of time to find true passion in cinema. It did take me, first of all, passion for life. I needed to find passion for life first, because I was also raised in a very, just like any other Indian family, I was raised in an Indian family with a father who gave me the freedom to do anything that I wanted. He never, he always believed that enikinnadokka cheyanulla freedom undayirunnilla, but I want to be able to provide my my child with everything. He never forced me into education. That's another thing. He never asked me to ace my grades, or whereas my mom was different. My dad raised me like a boy, and my mom would always remind me that I'm an Indian girl. So because of these conflicts while growing up, it took me a long time to find true passion for myself. Like, who am I? What is it that I want? Definitely, oru anna social media illa irunno. So before the coming of social media, I'm sure all of us lacked awareness in some way or the other. Until the age of 24, to be honest, I didn't even know why I was really doing the things that I wanted. I never asked myself the question why. But today, I mean, fast forward, I was, 2019, and I've actually found I've asked myself all the possible questions when I got my life back, of course. And I've also found the answers to most of them. And I'm still seeking. And I think that is the reason for passion, for true passion. When it comes to doing a business, I know everyone is getting into business or investments in one way or the other. So when I came on board B-Hub, the only thing that I had to say was, I really need to see change happen. I'm not interested. I'm passionately interested in the change. So be it in cinema, I feel that, I don't know if cinema and entrepreneurship is definitely correlated, because cinema has become full-on business now. And there are both good and bad sides to it. And I'm glad that I've been part of that transformational phase of cinema. But I think whatever you choose to do, it's very important to do it only if you fully understand it and if you fully love it. Today we have women who can, who can at least voice everything that they want to in cinema. It's not like back in the day. So therefore leading, therefore women are turning into producers today, and we are giving back to what once upon a time gave us something, right? So I'm seeing a beautiful paradigm shift here, and I'm enjoying this process of transformational, women going through change, men being a little careful before they speak to women, therefore reflecting a lot of respect, and because avade aanu equality varunathu, right? They also have to think before speaking to us, and at the same time, shifting this, steering a little away from the question that you asked me, I feel that revolting against men, or looking down on them, is not a way to show that you're a better woman. I feel that there is a place for everybody in society, right? We're all equal. We all need to grow. We all have roles in our own genders. We cannot stray from that. I think being a woman itself is our biggest strength. It's our biggest gift. We have this emotional and emotional depth, that even intellectual depth, that emotional intelligence, which is very important. Our depth ettum kududalulla streegalkana. So why not use that, as a powerful tool, a tool that is useful but not going against society, societal norms also. So coming back to your previous question, I feel that the women of today should stop. One thing we need to stop is following the usual norms of getting your child married off at a certain age. These all have huge societal impact when it comes to the citizens that they become tomorrow. You can delay those things. I mean, today we are all growing older gracefully. And I think today we, at 30s, we are looking like how our mothers used to look when they are in their 20s. So the world is changing. We are actually more feistier. We're more hungry than, you know, we are as or more hungry than our counterparts are, than our men are. Therefore, we can delay certain processes that used to be followed, you know, by our ancestors. This can create a huge reform in the way a girl child or a boy child thinks. Therefore, turning them into better citizens in you know, for changing India is what I feel. Yeah.
The major problem what the Kerala startups or the entrepreneurs face is the lack of visibility. They don't have a platform to showcase their products or services or themselves. So, as a person who travel around the world, we know that Keralites are the real change makers. So, how we can bring that change in our society?
And there is a lot of change happening in the society. Yes, of course, getting a platform where they will get taken and they will get recognized is very important. So any mother could ask, why should I send my child to this and, you know, get take him or her away from conventional education and, you know, give them an extra, you know, an extra platform for them? Is it to overburden them? But it's not. So when a child gets skilled in a very very specific way, a person who's actually looking for that specific skill comes for them and takes them, right? Because we have a lot of educational institutions that are, you know, sending out graduates, and all of them are unemployed. That's a big situation. So a parent could definitely ask, oh, I spent this much to educate my child, but he or she still not got placement anywhere. Why? Are they asking themselves, why is my child lacking something? That social skills illa, interpersonal skills illa, language is a big problem, confidence illa. So these are all coming because the child knows that when you put me in front of, you know, take me to another country, put me in a big presentation or an interview, I know I won't be able to perform. We need to develop those skills, and those are very, very small interpersonal skills which can be developed in a platform like B-Hub, where this child is not only talking to another 10-year-old, but he or she is getting the opportunity to interact openly, without judgment, without any barrier, with a 35-year-old skilled person or a 40-50-year-old person, right? So the child comes back home with a lot of facets added, like a lot of, you know, badges added to that person's life. And therefore, that person gets socially recognized faster because he or she is a little differently skilled compared to other people who are in their circle. And that will get recognized. I feel today we are in a world where there's over-recognition of people who are who have average skills as well. So I don't see a reason why people who really stick out and who are genuinely skilled will not get recognized.
What made Mamta so strong? I can see that fire in your voice.
Definitely having strong parents, that's for sure. They're stronger than me. They've given me a lot of love, and they've also, when I told them don't coddle me too much, they've kept their distance too. So I think that's what helped me become the person that I am today. They helped me find myself, and they knew that they had to let me go, because they also came to a point where they didn't know whether I would really be around for a long time. So they let me be who I wanted to be, for, you know, be whatever I wanted to be for the rest of my life. So when they made that change, it became a first time I felt that it was my responsibility. Everything became my responsibility. How I thought about myself, why am I here? Why did I go through all that? Why did this happen to me? All the whys. It's the first time that I asked myself all those whys. Because otherwise, I think I was very comfortable. We're all very comfortable, right? With our socio-economic backgrounds. We're all happy. We're all growing up in loving families. It gave me an opportunity to meet with people who were lacking in some way, you know, who were coming from different family backgrounds, probably might have lost their father when they were young. And I started meeting people who had a story to tell. And their stories inspired me. And I was like, oh, this is just another, you know, this is just another ordeal that I'm going through. And I'm going to push through this. After all, even if I fall again, I know I can go to my parents, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to live fully. I'm going to live passionately. I've been given this life again for a purpose. Live it with full of love. Whatever I do it with a lot of love. And there's another thing to it. As much as I think like an entrepreneur, I've also realized that the moment I get to the core of it, I steer very far away from the money aspect of it or the business aspect of it. Because the moment I start mingling with the environment, I'm like, there's so much that I can do, and I'm doing it with love. Like, nothing can equate next to that. Like, I believe in prana, I believe in life force, I believe in those things. People never ask me, like, how do you start your day? Like, I wish those were the questions that were asked to me in an interview. I get surprised by when I see people who sleep until 8 o'clock in the morning, and I just don't get that. And from a very young age, I've woken up at, like, you know, 5:30, 6 o'clock. The first thing I do is have my lemon water and then go to the gym. And that's been a systemic, that's just who Mamta is. And she always was like that. And she was also like that before cancer. So those habits, habit formation happens in the house. So therefore, again, thanks to my parents for that. I know I'm elaborating on this, but I cannot thank my parents any less. Those are the things which I could always fall back on. I always tell my friends that I'm a slave of my own routine. Because these habits in the fallout, I cannot function. So I'm otherwise I live a very meditative state of life, and I'm very calm from inside.